was asked to present something that you may not be familiar to. It means this is what we call in at the European level the cohesion policy, which is in fact the regional development policy. And my intention is just to give you an overview of what happens with this policy and the territorial dimension of the European continent, how it has been taken into account in the policies, and where we are currently. So it is a very accelerated view of what happened for 25 years. 25 years, because this regional policy was created only in 1985, 86, 88. So, well, to begin with that, the idea is that the territorial dimension was not really taken into account at the beginning, at the very beginning of the EU, because, the founders, just after the Second World War, were very, very cautious as regards what they considered as the old-fashioned, the old organizations that were the provinces, the small regions, which were really not really progressive. And so if we are thinking of who was missing in who or what was missing in the table, around the table in Rome when the head of government signed the treaty, there were two important elements missing. The first one were women, so there is, we see in the photo a large number of men, only men. And the other missing entity were the regions and the provinces. However, and we will see it, they are there now, and they are very important. My presentation will be focused first on this historical overview of the territorial dimension as an element, a very crucial element of the European culture, the European wealth, not only historical heritage, but also because it's create the economy, the relationship with the landscape, also because we have natural resources, the way we are developing it, etc., etc. So then I will talk of a question which is it okay? I mean, because of course things are well developing. So is it okay for the cohesion policy, which is mainly the European policy, which is interested in this territorial dimension, and we'll see that this is not as good in a good situation as we may wish. And finally, I will just explain where we are currently and what is missing, which is a bit different from original development policy. It is a special planning policy, and I will make an explanation. So I will begin with something more political and legal, the legal framework of that. So the legal framework is rather surprising, because since the beginning, even if the region were not really most of the countries that signed the first treaty, there were central states and centralized state. So the idea of region was not there. However, in the preamble, there was this idea of reduction of disparities between regions. It was not used, and it just began with agriculture, with the notion of mountainous areas that are thriving for agriculture, and also less favored areas, especially where in the, at that date we were thinking of the northern, the Scotland, and also this kind of island where it was not possible really to have crops, but only to have to grow animals, and so it's not really you cannot really have a farm with that. So there are special measures. Then the Single Act in 1986, which recognized the idea and the objective of socio-economic cohesion, and then we had the idea that Europe should support and help the declining rural areas, and this is the creation, the date of creation, to some extent, of the cohesion policy. Then, and then you see every time new treaty with elements more focused on territorial specificities. Then we had this idea of peripheral regions, which are the island, for example, in France we have the region of Martinique, of Guadeloupe, and also Guyane, and also Canarias for Spain, etc. We have also later on the idea of island regions that are facing specific problems, and the notion that in fact territorial cohesion is something that the general services, so the public services, are trying to help and to really to create something as regards territorial cohesion in Europe, and they are very important at that day. It is not totally, it's rather important at that date, because that was one time when the idea was trying to suppress the public services and to replace them by more market services. And so saying they are important for territorial cohesion, that was rather important. Later on, and it's the last treaty, we have this notion of not only socio-economic cohesion, but also territorial cohesion, with a large list of areas that should benefit of territorial cohesion, and they are mountainous areas, so it's the list is there, they are the rural areas, they are also the remote places, the the low-density population in the north, for example, northern Finland and northern Sweden, etc. Then, this was for the legal framework. The second element was the fact that besides the treaties, you have financial support with funds, and so regions were able to get some money from the EU to make development, and especially regional development, with the support of two major funds. They were created as structural funds, so the idea was to help them to make investment and change the structure, the economic structure, and the socio-economic structure of the region. Not to make the structural reform, which is another word used today, but it was very far from that. Also, there was something, so they are really the acronyms of awful things, but so there is a fund in for rural areas, and there is also a fishery fund to help the regions that were restructuring their activities as regards fishery to help them to restructure. And the cohesion fund was created mostly to help the countries that have to prepare to the EMU, and it was focused on infrastructure, in environment, and also in as regards to some extent the roads and this kind of thing. So now they are considered, we have now five funds, and there was no merging funds for this stuff. Also, another kind of element were these programs, these community initiative programs, they were mainly much more focused on specificities as regards territories, restructuring agriculture, or restructuring also all problems of cities, so it was called urban. LEADER was a program for, and it's still there, a program for rural areas, rural development in rural areas. INTERREG program is the program of cooperation. So you may know this kind of map of cross-border cooperation, and you'll see how it's important, especially in the Central Europe, because almost it covers all the country. In other big countries, in fact, the areas, not the region, because it's smaller than the regions, that are eligible to get funds to make cross-border cooperation. Well, it's generally about 100 kilometers far from the border as regards the perimeter. So you see the kind of programs and the idea that you have also maritime cooperation, this kind of stuff.
The Europe House was built on Interreg funds, well, remodeled on Interreg funds.
So, this was, in fact, the idea that cooperation is as much as important, and that was a slogan that Jacques Delors, who was one of the famous presidents of the Commission, he said that we need cooperation, we need competition, but we need also cohesion. And so then, so Interreg is mostly focused on cross-border cooperation. There are also other type of cooperation that we shall see later. And PESCA, it was one time, it has disappeared and it's renewed on another name, for these regions, these coastal regions experiencing restructuring of fisheries. So there is another kind of instrument, which is not so much financial but legal, this idea of these cross-border and the idea that when you are managing a program at cross-border level, you need really a unique system, and these are these EGTT, European Grouping for Territorial Cooperation. Then you have also local development support, which is not a special territorial focus, with a territorial focus. However, it's very much important. As far as when it was created, the idea was to directly give money from the commission level to small groups, including the idea of these kind of groups are not only managed by the local authorities, but also managed by the economic actors at the local level and by the civil society. And they had to provide a program, and they were given some money to develop this program. And that was really something very new at that day. It was in 1991. And then the other kind of development and programs developed. ITI is something which is more territorial, so for the big project at the in the urban areas, so integrated programs. And the macro-regional strategies, you probably have heard of it as it is there. I mean, there is one which is covers the Danube basin. There is another one for the Baltic Sea region. There is another one, so they have created, been created rather recently, so that was 5-6 years ago. The Alpine Space was just created 2 years ago. And the Adriatic Ionian Seas is another region. So the territorial, so you will see there are different kind of, so transnational cooperation. There are some, like the Baltic Sea, who are really, this is the green one, who have really the label macro region, so they benefit from more money, more other instruments, etc. The others are just transnational cooperation. So then you have the Danube cooperation, the Alpine is the green one, but another green one, and the Alpe Adriatica, which is in Italy, etc. And so you have also other cooperation, transnational, but they are in the Latin America, in Caribbean Sea, etc. They correspond to the places where there are island franchises in the West Indies, Caribbean. So that's for the tools. Then, at the same time, the money grew up. This is the money given, well, the budget of the cohesion policy. So in at the beginning it was ECU, because the euros did not exist. And so we passed, since the beginning, from 16% of the EU budget to 31%. And the second programming period, the amount of money at least doubled, or more than doubled. It was the same share of the European budget, but the budget doubled. And then it doubled, did not double, so it means that the situation just, well, there was no such an increase of the EU budget. And so we're passing to 30, well, a third of the EU budget, and then a bit more than the EU, a third of the EU budget. And now we can consider, because it's the cohesion policy is only 30% currently of the EU budget. However, with the other funds, the region, the rural fund, and also the EFFMA, so it means that the fishery fund, they represent much more. And so in fact, we can consider that about 40% of the EU budget is dedicated to territorial development, to the support of regional development, which is something rather important. The result is that, especially after the crisis, this budget was very important, because the idea of the allocation of money, it is a multi-annual program. So there are contracts between the EU, the member states, and the regions for 7 years, and the amount of money is already allocated, and it doesn't move. So in fact, represent, of course, for the regions that are lagging behind, or the less developed, an amount of money which is important. But it is much more important when, and that was the case during the crisis, the national budgets stopped giving money, allocating money to the local or regional investment. And so, in fact, as the money was allocated and still was allocated at EU level, it was possible to continue to manage and to develop these investments, and they represent a huge amount of money, and they secure investment at regional level. So you see that at EU level, that was 2.5% of public investment in 2007. And after the crisis, 18%, especially in 2013. At national level, so it means if you see precisely what happened in some countries, and for example, Hungary was one of the bigger examples of the importance of the EU money to support local and local public investment and regional public investment. So. It represented in during between 2010 and 2013, the EU funding represented 74% of the public investment. So that's rather important, and it represents still about the same amount of money later on.
Marjorie, is that 74% of total public investment in Hungary or regional investment?
For
the last figure you've just given.
I think that's the total.
Mm-hmm.
No, no, that's enormous. the change linked to the crisis is really very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
Generally, when the allocation is done, what happens is that the focus is on the percentage of the national GDP. So it was supposed not to be more, just to be sure that it can be absorbed and it doesn't create too much dependence. The idea is no more than 3% or no more than 2.5% of GDP. But what a new focus with the crisis, a new focus was really this idea of continuing to invest at regional level. And that's suddenly the proportion is much more important. Well, then, what was also important is this idea of concentration, because this money is not a traditional. I mean, the EU, the cohesion policy is not just to give money to the states, and the less developed states and the less rich member states. The idea that it is conditioned by the idea that the regions, it is allocated to the regions, and so that these regions that are less developed, so it means that their GDP per inhabitant is lower than 75% of the average of the other regions. Currently, there are in fact three types of regions. You may know that or you don't know. So they are the less developed regions under 75% of the average in Europe. There are these transition regions. In fact, there is a new concept which represents those who are improving their situation, but however, and for example, you see the region of in orange, the region of around Warsaw, and so they have improved their situation. However, it is a transition. On the other side, you have other regions, for example, in France and in UK, also in Spain, where they were very good, they were very well before the crisis. However, after the crisis, their situation worsened. And so the idea is that they are not so bad, but however, they need help. And the most developed region, so they are in green. So in fact, you see how they currently. You still have a very high divide between East and West of Europe. However, things are a bit different. Well, it should be a much clearer divide without the crisis, because the crisis hurt very strongly the southern country, and so they re-entered in. In these
what is the green spot in the middle of the purple there?
Bratislava.
Oh, that's just Bratislava. Oh,
interesting. Yes, we cannot see Vienna. Yes, because it's just. And you have also the Prague.
It's Budapest, not Bratislava. Yeah, that's the green is probably.
It's Budapest. Bratislava, but it's probably it's Bratislava, yes, there. You're right.
It's not Bucharest.
You know better than me the country geography. So as regards, I wanted to make a focus, special focus as regards the cities and the urban dimension. Because, as I told you, the regions were there, but were not there around the table in Rome in 1957. However, they were in the treaty. The word cities doesn't appear even now. I mean, you don't see any word making think of urban cities, towns, in the treaties. Why? In fact, there is a continuous fight between regions and cities, and still they are very competitive. There is a great competition between them. And however, now the urban dimension has been accepted, but it was a longer march for them. Initially, the EU solidarity was just evoked as just to tackle urban problems. So it means that cities were not mentioned, but the first time they were mentioned was linked to urban problems. So the urban, so they were small programs, or they were small measures, actions, or sometimes communication, or sometimes general programs. As regards the question of social exclusion in cities, crime, insecurity, air pollution, traffic congestion, energy pollution, but also energy consumption, etc., etc. So there were, since I would say the mid-90s, references to cities, but as problems. Later on, and sometimes, so they lasted some time, they lasted 5 years, 6 years, but they were rather unstable. A bit later, the mayors, because the mayors are very powerful, they are very visible, they insisted a lot in saying, but we can solve also problems, we can be good, we are the economic locomotives of the EU and not only the regions. So it means that also as cooperation develops, the idea of giving labels, giving awards for some cities that are doing well, developed also. So there was this idea of cultural capital of Europe, then you had at the same time green capitals of Europe, smart champion, smart cities, energy efficiency cities, etc., etc. Many, many networks, many, many levels. So it gives a positive idea of the cities. Very late, because it was only in 2011, a paper for the first time was issued by the Commission, giving a real vision of Europe, of cities in Europe. And not only thinking of cities as problems or as locomotive of the economy, but really as cities. And that was this City of Tomorrow's report. At some years after, it was decided by the member state, by the government, to develop an urban agenda with the idea of having several things to do with cities and developing the idea of having urban policies in common or this kind of thing. Currently, I mean, they are, I talk of ITI, so this integrated investment for cities. There are also sustainable development programs for cities, etc. And so it means that for the current programming period, from 2014 to 2020, the cities can benefit from money, and they have some allocated funds for them, and the region are supposed to give them the money. And DG Regio has changed its name now. It's not only DG for regional affairs, but also for regional and urban affairs. However, things are not perfect. And the question of territorial approach is really in opposition with the traditional approach of sectoral approach. And in fact, the idea that when you want to promote a territorial approach, you say you need to integrate sectoral policies. So it means that what is really important is territory, is the place, and not only the sectoral policy. So to some extent, you give priority to this territorial approach to the other sectoral approach, which is something very, which upsets the ministers, because if you see how a government is organized, how the Commission is organized, European Commission, it is organized by sectors. So you have a minister in charge of energy, a minister in charge of employment, a minister in charge of social affairs, of transport, of agriculture, of energy, etc., etc. And saying that what we should have is an integrated approach is something that most, even in at national level, sometimes at regional level, people and administration are not ready to accept. So it means that it is a continuous competition and sometimes fight between these two approaches. Well, there was a very big debate, and I think that's interesting just to think of what kind of development we want to have at in the European continent. There was a big debate at international level, but with international organization. Some say we should have place-based policies. So it means focused really on the territory and its specificity. On the opposition, others, and that was the World Bank at that stage, who said, no, what we need are place-blind policies. If we want to help people, they have to move, and we shall provide opportunities for them if they are in cities. The other approach, place-based policy, is, as regards Europe, saying people do not tend so much to move. If we really want to get balanced development all around the Europe, we should give new opportunities for people wherever they live, wherever they work, and they will not be obliged to move and to go to cities if, well, sometimes it's not just small cities, they need to go to the capital. So in fact, this is really something which is not just a question of policy, but really the kind of model of development we want or not to promote in Europe. Well, so there was this big debate, but at the same time, there was another debate, which was, that's nice to have a regional development policy, however, what we need is really to get out of the crisis, and there is a big strategy, which is called EU 2020 strategy, with different sectoral priorities, and this cohesion policy should contribute to that. So it means that just to be sure to get still to one-third of the budget, the ministers in charge of cohesion policy accepted that the cohesion policy should contribute to all these thematic objectives, so thematic is a nice word just to say sectoral objectives, of the EU 2020 strategy. So currently we could say that it's a failure. Well, currently, because things are moving, we can hope that things are changing. And in fact also, the idea that it will be implemented at regional level, they should be implemented in an integrated manner, that did not change. And also, and that's something which may be a bit a problem, the regional performance, the ability to converge and to catch up, this performance is assessed according to 5 sectoral targets that are the national, the EU targets in employment, R&D, renewable energy, CO2 emissions, education poverty that are developed at national level and also at regional level. So it means also that currently maybe the battle between the territorial and the sectoral approach has not been won by the territorial approach. There are other kind of threats which are not just a question of territorial approach, but of regionalization and decentralization. Well, obviously, the idea of promoting an economic governance and means that it will have to be centralized to be efficient. And so, in fact, the European semester, which is a system of monitoring the progress of the member states as regards different things on financial and economic issues. Well, this, to some extent, stopped the relative autonomy of the social and the territorial policies because it was said that they should also participate and be monitored in this sectoral approach. The fact that the idea of we should better spend the EU money or the public money, this better spending movement, led to the introduction of many new conditionalities, just like conditionalities used by the IMF, and also it was an attempt to re-centralize things and to give less autonomy to regions to develop their own policies. There is another kind of threat coming from the new financial instruments because, there is the development of the idea that maybe some rich regions do not need subsidies, but they need more repayable loans, and so in fact change completely the idea. And also the Juncker plan, which supported the new investments, and it was designed to be a booster to boost the private investment after the crisis. So it went well. However, the question is that it just supported the best project without taking into account where they are. And so the result of the first round of the Juncker program is that the projects that have been supported are mostly situated in the more developed region or the central places, central cities. So it means that it is rather placed back. And a last threat is the fact that, as 27 countries without Croatia, because Croatia did not really participate in the bargain, but the member states that are more different, that they pursue different objectives, etc. In order to get a final agreement, many innovative ideas were just put as optional and not mandatory. And so, in fact, there are many, many options open to the government, but also it means, or the regions, but it means that we are now with a more flexible cohesion policy or a la carte policy. And this is, it can be nice to say that they have flexibility, etc. However, the question is that, does it look like a European policy? Well, maybe it's not really a problem, but it is because, in fact, the coordination mechanisms are rather weak. And finally, the only mechanisms that are very strong are financial control, administrative control, so it means that they are really, it is not the good way of coordinating. not so much strategic. And the question is that maybe it's not a problem if there are national policies for regional development or territorial development. Well, apart from some countries, we should accept that this is not the case. Many countries have, after 25 years or 20 years, considered that finally, if the cohesion policy takes care of that, that's a question for regions, that's a question for EU, well, why should we bother with that? And the result is that the money went somewhere else. So it means that as we got the thinking of regional policy at national level, it really, it's rather weak, generally speaking. Especially I can talk of my country, because my country is supposed to be traditional special planning, just like Netherlands, it was special planning, very fond of this kind of thing. And now, well, the fact is that we do not really have a national policy. Well, so I'm arriving more or less to the last part, which is what is missing. So the question is that, well, that's good to have a regional development policy at EU level, supporting regional development connected by regions. However, what happens if you just have a look at the whole territory, the whole continent? And it appears that, of course, you have this idea, and this is a debate, or the notion of EU added value. So the EU added value is something which is linked to the fact that at EU level, you see what happens on the map, and you say, well, no problem, everything is balanced, and, well, our model is precisely this idea of giving more opportunity to everywhere without obliging them to move. Well, so, in fact, if you have this idea of what the EU should do, the EU should take care of things that are minor for the others. For example, the borders. The borders are not a priority, generally speaking, for the countries. So it takes into account this idea of cooperation. The EU should take into account also some major problems, just like this idea of the Danube River, or some seas, some coastal problems, some environmental problems, that all the big rivers that just cross many countries, etc. This kind of thing is also really where the EU can have added value. However, there is still something which is not obvious, is the addition of different regional development or national territorial development makes an EU territorial development policy. Not so much. And, well, if now we are not so only, it is not only a problem of big infrastructure, so you have, of course, these programs of infrastructure, but if it is not only a problem of infrastructure, but also a problem of availability for services, for hospitals, for clean air, all this stuff, well, there is not really this kind of policy, and even if it has not to be thought as a policy, it should have been thought as a strategy. And so it's not really the case. It is really fragile, still very fragile. And currently, the discussion may be, and is there on the table, is convergence the only aim, the economic convergence, so it means asking the lagging behind region just to catch up the others. Is it the only aim and the only objective of the territorial policy at EU level? Do we have other kind of policies that are important for regions, important for places, for people, but and not only sectoral policies, but well? And if it is the case, what kind of criterion should be used just to help the regions that are the more fragile, especially, for example, as regards energy, as regards climate change, as regards the risk linked to climate change. Also, there are other kind of problems as regards the digital challenge and the possibility to invest and other things. So the current debate is, do we only have to take into account GDP per inhabitant as a major or the only criterion to allocate money to the region, or should we take other criteria? Already the discussion have been used. However, now it's more, I think that it is really accurate. Earlier the idea was, what should we bother? We have this criterion, it's okay. However, currently we understand that it is not the case, that we should also rethink the cohesion policy as a real solidarity policy, and this policy needs probably to be rethought and rebuilt. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.